Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Noah Fins.
Thank you very much. Thank you, and thank you for coming out. Do you realize this is the 50th Walter Camp Football Foundation All-America Dinner? So you guys are part of a big deal. The 50 anniversary. Thanks for, you know, you guys being here is part of what makes this such a success year after year. So we know that the Walter Camp Football Foundation honors the top college football players in the country every year. It is the oldest All-America team. It is the most prestigious All-America team. And it is, and you guys can feel free. Thank you for applauding. We'll take that. But it is also by far the best. And especially for our community, because here we take this national award ceremony and make it all about our community. And that's what the Walter Camp Football Foundation is all about. Spent the last couple days hanging out and talking with All-Americans from this year and All-Americans from years and years ago. And they talk about how great it is that they get to come back year after year. It's the only All-America team where this happens. They come back year after year to what has become a fraternity. And not only that, but our community benefits because they come in and they become part of our community. They meet with our school children and tell them the importance of their schoolwork and staying in schools. No, it's not just about football, it's about our kids. We're over 2,500 area school kids at the Floyd Little Athletic Center hearing from these larger-than-life people, telling them the importance of school. Then these guys get together year after year and go visit hospitals to put a smile on faces that might not otherwise have a smile on them. David Fulcher, whom we'll hear from in a couple minutes here, he's been doing that 17 straight years, going and giving autographs and, more important, smiles to six people in our hospitals. That's what the Walter Camp Football Foundation is all about. That's why these guys come back year after year. And that's why, in addition to that, all the money raised from this goes to local charities. That's why this organization is more than just football. It's about our community, and it's about giving back. So a big hand, 50 years of this dinner, the Walter Camp Football Foundation. I sense that we have a good, rowdy, fun group tonight, so let's move on. Ladies and gentlemen, please turn your attention to the entrance archway as we introduce the Walter Camp Football Foundation officers and honored guests. Immediate past president, Jim Monaco. Secretary, Donald Crouch. Vice President, Mario Coppola. Vice President, Tony Mortali. Treasurer and past president, Bill Raffone. And our president-elect, Mike Madera. Ladies and gentlemen, this being the 50-year anniversary, we would also like to recognize and call into the building past major award winners. A Walter Camp Football All-America from 1981. He was the Man of the Year in 2008. He's a member of the Walter Camp Football Foundation All-Century Team from Michigan State. Please welcome Morton Anderson. The Walter Camp Football Foundation Man of the Year from 1999. He is the voice of all football, Gil Brandt. A Walter Camp Football Foundation All-American 1987. He was the Player of the Year, the Heisman winner. He is a member of the College Football Hall of Fame and a member of the Walter Camp All-Century Team from Notre Dame, Tim Brown. An All-America from the 1984 team. He's also a member of the Walter Camp All-Century Team, a member of the College Football Hall of Fame from Georgia, Kevin Butler. A 1982 All-America. The Walter Camp Football Foundation Alumni Award winner in 1995, a member of the College Football Hall of Fame, the NFL All-80s team, out of Pittsburgh, Jim Covert. A 1995 All-America. He was also the Player of the Year, the Heisman Award winner, the Maxwell winner, the Doak Walker winner, College Football Hall of Fame member out of Ohio State University, Eddie George. A 1974 All-America. He was the Alumni Award winner in 2013 out of North Carolina, Ken Huff. A Walter Camp Football Foundation Connecticut Player of the Year in 1995 and in 96 out of Wisconsin, Tarek Salah. A 1989 and 1990 All-America. The Lombardi winner in 1990, a member of the College Football Hall of Fame, and on the Walter Camp All-Century Team. Out of Notre Dame, Chris Zorich. Tonight's Walter Camp National Awards Dinner is sponsored by KeyBank. Representing our dinner sponsor, please welcome Jeff Hubbard, who is the president of the Connecticut and Western Massachusetts market at KeyBank. From Arizona State University, he's the current president of the Walter Camp All-America Alumni Association and was the Walter Camp Alumni Award winner in 2009 from our 1985 All-America team, Mr. David Fulcher. Up next is our Master of Ceremonies from ESPN Sports Center and the University of Missouri. Please welcome back, John Anderson. We have four members of the 1991 All-America team joining us tonight to celebrate their silver anniversary as Walter Camp All-Americans. From the University of Michigan, wide receiver and kick returner, MVP of Super Bowl 31, winner of the Heisman Trophy, the Maxwell and Harley Awards, and our 1991 Walter Camp Player of the Year, Desmond Howard. From Florida State University, a two-time All-American, 1991 and 92, please welcome linebacker Marvin Jones. From the University of Michigan, another two-time All-American at offensive tackle, please welcome back Greg Skrepanek. And at defensive back from the University of Miami, welcome Darrell Williams. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we welcome into the hall our Walter Camp 2016 All-America players. On the defensive line, a 6'3", 265-pound junior from Nashville, Tennessee, out of the University of Tennessee, Derek Barnett. A 6'3" linebacker, 247-pound senior from LSU, Kendall Beckwith. From Auburn, 6'4", 218-pound place kicker, Daniel Carlson. A 5'11", 213-pound junior running back out of Florida State, Dalvin Cook. At linebacker, a 6'4", 230-pound junior from Vanderbilt, Zach Cunningham. A defensive back, 6'2", 203-pound senior out of West Virginia, Rasul Douglas. Also at defensive back, 6'1", 203-pound sophomore from Alabama, Minka Fitzpatrick. Our kick returner is a 5'8", 190-pound sophomore from Pittsburgh, Quadri Henderson. On the defensive line, a 6'3", 250-pound junior out of Boston College, Harold Landry. A defensive back, 5'11", 186-pound senior out of Michigan, Jordan Lewis. On the offensive line, 6'8", 354-pound junior from Washington State, Cody O'Connell. Our next All-America is a 6 foot, 197-pound senior, a defensive back from LSU, Tre'Davious White. On the offensive line, he's 6'6", 288 pounds, a sophomore from Texas, Connor Williams. Our punter is a 6'2", 220-pound sophomore from Utah, Mitch Wischkowski. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm round of applause for these members of the 2016 Walter Camp All-America team. It is now my pleasure to introduce our Walter Camp Football Foundation major award winners. Grandmother and caregiver extraordinaire, please welcome our 2016 American hero from Charlotte, North Carolina, a graduate of UNC Charlotte, Sandra Adams. Our Walter Camp Football Foundation Coach of the Year, sponsored by the Charter Oak Insurance and Financial Services Company, is the head coach from the University of Colorado. Please welcome Mike McIntyre. A 1996 finalist for the Heisman, our 2016 Alumni Award recipient, won the Outland Trophy and was a two-time winner of the Lombardi Award. He went on to an outstanding professional career with the Super Bowl champion St. Louis Rams. Please welcome Walter Camp, two-time All-America offensive tackle from the Ohio State University, College and Pro Football Hall of Famer, Orlando Pace. A key member of the 1993 Florida State University National Championship team, he was the first-round draft pick of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers and also spent 6 years with the Atlanta Falcons. His 10,967 yards rushing and 49 touchdowns highlight an impressive NFL run. But his efforts off the field are even more extraordinary. Please welcome our 2016 Man of the Year, Warrick Dunn. The 1960 Walter Camp All-America end from the University of Pittsburgh, NFL Rookie of the Year, three-time Super Bowl champion, elected to the College Football Hall of Fame in 1968, the first ever tight end inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame. He played for the Bears, Eagles, and Cowboys, coached in Dallas, Chicago, and New Orleans. One of the most colorful commentators in the game today, please welcome our distinguished American, Iron Mike Ditka. And now, our 2016 Walter Camp Football Foundation Player of the Year, 6'3", 205-pound sophomore quarterback from the University of Louisville. Please welcome to New Haven, Walter Camp All-American Lamar Jackson. And now, please welcome the current president of the Walter Camp Football Foundation, Mr. Rob Kaufman. So bring your good times and your laughter too. We gon' celebrate your party with you. Come on now. Celebration. Let's all celebrate and have a good time.
All right, are we all here? Everybody settled in? Is there anybody who hasn't been introduced yet? Are we good? We're here. Ken, did we get you? Good, that's there. Who else? Art Stills over here. Art, are you? Can you see me okay from over there? Just want to make sure. Hi, everybody. How we doing? Good, you're awake. Thanks. I like the applause, even though every time that happened when I was young, my mom would say, don't clap, you're only going to encourage him. My name is John Anderson. I work in cable television. I am thrilled to be here. I don't know where I am on the dial, what channel, 28, 29? I move around a little bit. I am pleased to be back as MC. I was worried about that for a while. Looked like Lane Kiffin was going to do it, but then he and Nick Saban got together and they mutually decided I would be a better choice, so I'm here. Where is Noah? Noah braved the elements to get here. We're a little late. I blame Noah, but it was nice of him, so I didn't have to take up his duties. This is 20 years that Noah has introduced the procession. So on a night of anniversaries, 20 years for Noah. Now, if I can contribute something, that would be fantastic. I hope. I don't know. There are reports that my speech was leaked by the Wake Forest radio play-by-play guy, but hopefully we're okay. So with that, I welcome everyone to the 50th annual Walter Camp Football Foundation National Awards Dinner. This is a college football tradition where time seems to stand still. And I'm not just talking about everybody in their black tie dress and the nostalgia of the evening in the room. I'm talking about the actual length of the program. The Rose Bowl this year went 4 hours and 8 minutes. The national championship game went 4 hours and 12 minutes, and they got nothing on us. So settle in. But the real longevity we celebrate tonight is the half century of work the Walter Camp Football Foundation has done on behalf of college football. As I've said many times, it is the greatest game known to mankind. 50 years of preserving and promoting a legacy that dates all the way back to 1889, the very first Walter Camp All-America team. And for 50 years, they have honored legendary players and iconic coaches. Also in 1889 in South Carolina, they started a school called Clemson College. That would be the same Clemson that won the national title on Monday night, although I'm pretty sure, I mean, I know there was a playoff and they're number one. I think, though, you should be sharing that. I'm not sure they got the right Tigers because by my math, Clemson lost to Pitt. Pitt lost to Oklahoma State. Oklahoma State lost to Central Michigan. Central Michigan lost to Eastern Michigan, and Missouri shellacked Eastern Michigan by 40. So I feel like we could at least be co-champs or have a share of the national championship. We have 50 years in the room of this foundation's leadership, all of them now combing gray hair or have no hair at all. We have 50 years of reminding people how wonderful Walter Camp is and what he meant to this game. Otherwise, we'd be watching rugby or soccer. He's the guy that gave you the line of scrimmage and that were four downs and decided, hey, a touchdown, let's make that worth six. He came up with fourth down. He came down with 3 points for a field goal. And he's the guy that said, you know what? Instead of just having 50 people milling around here, let's put 11 on each side. The golden anniversary of the awards dinner here also honors the hall in which we eat and recognize these players tonight. This Yale Commons, it is a venue that holds as much college football history as any of the great stadiums in the game. I mean, all the greats of the last 50 years have been here. Not all of them played in a Rose Bowl or in the Sugar Bowl or in the Orange Bowl. Alas, this is the last home game we will have here in the hall as the university will be renovating this building, and thus for the next few years, the dinner will be somewhere else. I am assured it is not moving to LA. It is a neutral site that is yet to be determined. It will not be one of those college football neutral site games where we go to Australia to watch Cal and Hawaii play. But before you leave, I encourage everybody to look around and kind of drink this place in. Whether it's the chandeliers or the wooden beams, all these banners of football greatness and people of great character. Go into that rotunda and be dazzled by the marble that you see there and take an extra minute and go through the Memorial Hall. That's where the names of the Yalies who gave their last full measure are listed on that great curved wall. My friend here, Tom Lawley, pointed that out to me a few days ago because too many times I've just breezed by on the coat check. So take a minute and look. Tom, as always, my gratitude to you for helping me come into the foundation and for always graciously hosting my family, even when they're not as punctual as we'd like them to be. I have no doubt wherever the new dinner will be, table 51 will still be the hottest spot. But the future is for tomorrow. We are here to honor the present and celebrate the past as well. We are about Lamar Jackson taking your breath away. We are about Mike McIntyre making the Buffaloes in Boulder great once again, even without taking five downs to do it. It's a regular season that had us on the edge of our seats. It's 40 ball games that brightened our holidays. It is Ohio State and Michigan measured to the inch, By the way, we have guys from both schools here, and they still can't agree whether that was a first down or not. It's Harbaugh's khakis. It's the coaches that wear the visors, whether it's a night game, whether it's sunny, whether it's snowing, whether it's raining. It's the UConn women's basketball team winning 91 in a row. No, wait, I'm sorry. We'll put them in there. 91 in a row. It's Penn State back from nowhere. It is Washington back with bite. It's all three service academies, Army, Navy, and Air Force, winning 8, 9, and 10 games, respectively. It is the Big 12 staying at 10, the college football staying at 4. It is the pep rallies on Friday nights, the game on Saturday, and Sunday morning recoveries. It is the greatest rivalry of all, which is not Alabama-Auburn. It is not OU-Texas. It's not Notre Dame-USC. It's not even Harvard-Yale. But as my friend Gene Wojciechowski wrote on ESPN.com, it's college bars versus fake IDs. And if you will say this with me, it's also about USC song girls. I know there's an NFL playoff game going on right now. It will, without a doubt, draw a lot of eyeballs. People like to see the greatest living American, Tom Brady, play, but college football is better than even Tom. College football is better because people do not watch college football with their eyes. We watch college football with our heart. And the Walter Camp Football Foundation and this dinner tonight, the awards and the winners that you will hear from tonight, are all about heart. So I welcome you and enjoy the evening. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like you to please stand as we welcome longtime Walter Camp member, Officer Bill Barone, who along with New Haven Register essay contest winner Maxwell Warren, love Maxwell, great youngster, they will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, and that will be followed by the singing of our national anthem, Austin Rose, Swartnowitz, and Brett Pellegrino.
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America. And to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
Thank you, Austin Rose. Thank you, Brett. Now, serving as tonight's Walter Camp chaplain, here to give tonight's invocation, we welcome the Right Reverend Owen Sanderson, pastor of Christ Lutheran Church in Hamden.
Let us pray. Father God, we live in a busy, chaotic world. It is difficult for us to take time from our busy schedules, but tonight we take our time out to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the Walter Camp Foundation All-American Dinner. In the shadow of Walter Camp Arch, we bring together to honor young men and others who have contributed to the great game of football. Each honoree is a symbol of leadership and loyalty. Each has represented their school with dedication and honor. May this banquet tonight be a lasting memory of their dedicated efforts to the great game of football. And may our gathering of applause be a symbol of our simple thanks. Now, Lord, we give you thanks for the bounty we are about to receive. May it strengthen our bodies and nourish us, that we might all better serve thee. In thy holy name we pray. God bless America.
Thank you, Reverend. It is time now to acknowledge all the outstanding men who have proudly served the Walter Camp Football Foundation as president. Six of those guys have had to put up with me. If the past presidents in attendance this evening would kindly rise and remain standing as your name is called. Bill O'Brien. Bill Lavelle. Sam Burrell. Vin Fariselli. Ben Tortora. Ernie Williams. Kevin O'Brien. Bob Gargiulo. Eddie Pellegrino. Partner in crime, Tom Lally. Bernie Pellegrino. Thank you for loaning us the boy to sing. Bill Raffone. Alan Jackson. John Barbarotta, John Marks, and Jim Monaco. Also, and with a great deal of sadness, but a full and hearty appreciation, we acknowledge two former presidents who have passed away. Lou Hurwitz, who died last April, and the amazing Don Scharf, who we lost just last week. Lou and Don's service to Walter Camp was immeasurable and particularly outstanding during the critically important formative years of the foundation. A moment of silence as they will be sorely missed. And now, a round of applause for these gentlemen who have worked so hard over the years to help preserve and promote the good name of Walter Camp. They have served Walter Camp. They have dealt with the stage fright of having to speak in front of this entire room of 1,000 people. The guy who is sitting here sweating it out tonight, current president of the Walter Camp Football Foundation, Mr. Rob Kaufman. Rob, it's your room, bud.
Good evening. It is truly my honor to welcome you to the 50th annual Walter Camp Dinner sponsored by KeyBank. Tonight is a night of celebration. Of course, we're gathered here to celebrate the 127th Walter Camp All-America team and major award winners, but we also celebrate 50 years of the Walter Camp Football Foundation, 50 years of giving back to the community through hospital visits, youth football clinics, annual toy drives, staying school rallies, and Special Olympics, just to name a few, along with our monetary donations to various charities. Even during tough economic times, the foundation has persevered. So we salute and thank all of you for your financial support through the purchase of dinner tickets, advertisements, and sponsorships. We celebrate the countless number of All-Americans and major award winners who for the past 50 years have come into our community, not only to be honored, but more importantly, to enable the foundation to achieve its mission of supporting humanitarian programs and activities. We celebrate the all-volunteer membership of the foundation, who for the past 50 years have devoted their hearts and souls into making this the best college football awards weekend in the country, and to ensure that the foundation continues to grow and flourish in the name of Walter Camp, the father of American football. And finally, we celebrate John Anderson, who after 10 years will be retiring as our master of ceremonies. He's always added wit and wisdom to our festivities and will be missed on the dais. Yesterday morning at our media alumni brunch, John became an honorary member of the foundation and he couldn't be more deserving. Please a round of applause for John. In closing, I would like to personally dedicate this dinner to my late mother, and on behalf of the foundation, I'd like to dedicate this dinner to our late presidents, Don Scharf and Lou Hurwitz. Thank you, and have a great evening.
And now, the public servants who were elected to office by a 12-person college playoff committee and pockets of the general public here in Connecticut. From our host city of New Haven, please welcome Mayor Tony Harp.
Thank you very much, and good evening, everybody. It is my great pleasure to welcome all of you to New Haven. I'm so pleased to join you for tonight's Walter Camp dinner. As I've said other years, I'm eager for everyone involved in and with the Walter Camp Football Foundation to know how pleased New Haven is to be the home field for this annual event. You honor us with your presence. And as most of you already know, it's entirely appropriate for New Haven to be the host city. Walter Camp, considered by many to be the father of American football, was raised right here in New Haven. He attended Yale and was the captain of Yale's football team for 3 years. After his college playing days, Walter Camp coached the Yale football team for 5 years. And as you've heard, he's credited with implementing the 11-man sides, the system of downs, the line of scrimmage, the quarterback position, the forward pass, yard lines, and the modern point system. Every single one of these features we now take for granted in the modern game. Other features of the game you play and excel at playing are also sometimes taken for granted, but they are likely even more important. Qualities like commitment, sportsmanship, being part of a team, learning how to win, and learning how to lose. These are the unwritten rules of football and other team sports that serve for a lifetime and improve our chances for long-term success. Each of you here tonight has distinguished yourself on the football field, and I congratulate you for those accomplishments. And tonight, I encourage each of you to remain committed to continuing success beyond football and beyond sports. Tonight, I encourage you to continue that pursuit of excellence in everything else you attempt in your lifetime. Walter Camp adjusted to life after playing football and made history doing so. Each of us has the opportunity to do that too. Congratulations to all of you, and I just want to take one moment to congratulate New Haven's own Class M state champions, the Hill House Academics. Congratulations, everybody. Have a ball.
All right, that's a lot of pregame introductions. Let's do championship football players. I need the Darien High School Blue Wave. Are they around here somewhere? There they are, ladies and gentlemen. We have players and coaches from several Connecticut high school teams with us tonight, but only one of them, two-time defending state LL champion. This morning at the Breakfast of Champions held at the Omni Hotel, the Walter Camp Football Foundation presented the Joseph W. Kelly Award, sponsored by NFP Sports. Emblematic of the state's best high school football team to Coach Rob Trifone and the Darien Blue Wave. So Coach T, you and your guys, stand up, make noise. There you go, 6 returning starters from last year's champs, and they still went 13-0 back-to-back. The winning streak is 25, and then the women go like 91. 25 is still pretty good. All right, we're down with 25. Congratulations. Make sure you eat your vegetables. Now, a quick moment, if I could, I want to have everyone that is an All-American or a past All-American stand up so that if people, as you have dinner, you can recognize if you were sitting next to an All-American. So we will hear from them later. They will be introduced more formally. But just our past All-Americans in the room, Tim Brown, I see you over there. Just stand up. It's not that hard, brother. Stand up, our All-Americans. There you go. More for them. Ken, that means you. Just, there you go. Perfect. Tarek, Mike Ruth's over there. Thank you, guys. A heartfelt welcome to all of you. David Fulcher will introduce them in more in-depth at a moment, moments later. The next part is easy, audience participation. You guys just get to eat. We'd love for you to stay seated best you can if you would. I want to let you know that the silent auction is going to close eventually. But for now, enjoy dinner, and we'll start in again here momentarily.
You are diamonds! Go be diamonds tonight. I love you. I'm proud of you. Be humble. Be confident. Play for each other and be the diamonds I know you are. Let's go roll the boat. It's not their fault. It's not their fault. Who's house?
Formation. Yeah. What do you call this, Greece?
That's the train.
Oh, remember one of the great entrances of all time?
Lewis at the five. Lewis gets crushed. Man, and it was the kicker who made the hit.
Please refrain from shooting lasers onto the field. Thank you.
It's my wife. I'll get right back to him at the press conference. She said, bring a gallon of milk home on the way home.
We'll be right back. At its core, college football is about pageantry, passion, drama, and tradition. A sport soaked in history. Memories of seasons past frozen forever in our minds. And every Saturday we wait, in certain yet suspenseful anticipation, for another moment that will take our breath away.
It's blocked! The nose! Blocked the PAT!
And Navy has its biggest upset victory in 32 years! The Tar Heels come in and steal one!
Fall 2016 was never short on theatrics, like the drama between the hedges on October 1st, when a freshman legend was born right before our eyes, or so we thought.
Eason has it, steps up, looks deep, goes down the left side. He's got a man open. Touchdown, Riley Ridley! Dobbs heaves it. They're bunched up in the end zone. It's tipped up. It's caught. It is caught. Jawan Jennings.
Touchdown! What are you freaking doing? What are you freaking doing? What are you doing?
Underneath the southern sunset of mid-November, with Clemson on a collision course for another unbeaten regular season, a three-touchdown underdog on the back of its fearless runner, silenced 81,000 in Death Valley.
Ryan Winslow to hold it for Chris Blewett to try to knock off number two at Clemson. All the way and good.
On the final weekend of the regular season, in arguably the most storied rivalry in all of college football, and with championship dreams on the line, Ohio State and Michigan staged a battle for the ages.
Give it to Curtis. Give it to Curtis.
Samuel cuts it back. Ohio State wins.
College football provides magical memories and has us always coming back for more. The surprises are never ending. The celebrations can last forever. And 2016 was no different.
College football fans are crazy. All of those plays, in one way or another, keep coaches awake at night. It is a wonderful profession. You get a whistle and a headset and some blood pressure medicine. Great stuff. The Walter Camp Coach of the Year Award is sponsored by the Charter Oak Insurance and Financial Services Company. Please welcome their Chief Executive Officer, Peter Novak, to present the honor for 2016. We're in good shape. The Packers don't play till tomorrow.
This is the first Saturday in a long time, man.
We are both very big Packer fans. So, the Walter Camp Coach of the Year for 2016 has been involved in the game of football his whole life. Mike McIntyre is the son of the late George McIntyre, who coached a number of programs between 1964 and 1999, including the head coaching stints at the University of Tennessee at Martin and Vanderbilt. For Mike, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. He played free safety at Vanderbilt for his dad, and when his dad left the Commodores, Mike transferred to Georgia Tech, earning his bachelor's in business management. After college, he was an assistant coach at the University of Georgia, where he received a master's in sports management. From Georgia, Mike moved on to assistant coaching positions at Davidson, UT Martin, Temple, Ole Miss, where he recruited and coached the All-American linebacker Patrick Willis. He spent 5 years in the NFL, first with the Cowboys and then with the Jets. He returned to the college ranks in 2008 after joining the staff at Duke, where he was awarded the American Football Coaches Association Assistant Coach of the Year. Mike was hired as his first head coaching position at San Jose State in 2010, where he took the Spartans from a 1-12 team to a 10-2 team in just 3 years. That success brought the University of Colorado calling. The Bucks hadn't had a winning record since 2005. They hired Coach McIntyre to fix that, and indeed he delivered this past season. When the Pac-12 predictions for 2016 were released early this year, the Buffaloes were not given much of a chance to do anything. In Coach McIntyre's previous three seasons, they had a combined 2-25 conference record, finishing last in the Pac-12 South in each of those seasons. Funny thing, though, 4 years of his tenure at Colorado, Coach believed his team would be poised for a breakout year. No stranger to rebuilding programs, he felt he had plenty of ammunition to support his belief. He had his kids for 4 years that he recruited. They were upperclassmen with plenty of experience, and they were hungry. It didn't take long for the Buffs to make a statement. They won four of their first six games, losing only to Michigan and USC, and then winning the final six regular season games over the likes of Arizona State, Stanford, UCLA, Arizona, Washington State, Utah, earning the right to battle the University of Washington, losing to the fourth-ranked Huskies in the Pac-12 championship and finishing the regular season with a 10-3 record, in what is considered one of the greatest turnarounds in college football history. Colorado was just the ninth Power 5 team since 1972 to win 10 or more games after finishing the previous season with four or fewer victories. As a result, they were selected to play in the Alamo Bowl in San Antonio against Oklahoma State, bowing to the 13th-ranked Cowboys. It was Colorado's first bowl appearance since 07. As his former boss at Duke, 2013 Walter Camp Coach of the Year, Dave Cutfletz, recently wrote to us, "Coach McIntyre coaches just as he played, smart, relentless, and with a passion that exceeds what most people can ever feel for the game of football." I hope his wife, Tricia, has enough room on the wall for the many Coach of the Year honors he's won this year. From the Pac-12, to Home Depot, to CBS, to AP, to Football Writers, the Dodd Trophy, and of course, the best for last. It is my privilege to present the 2013 Walter Camp Coach of the Year Award to Coach Mike McIntyre.
It's very unique tonight. It really relates to our Colorado Buffalo football team these past 4 years, culminating in a phenomenal year this year. The University of Colorado has a great history, a history that our young men walk by a national championship trophy every day. They walk by many All-American trophies and accolades. They walk by a Heisman trophy every day. And when you're in the town of Boulder, and as you run into people, when we got there, all they talked about is, why can't we be like the past? You know, coach, can you just let us stay through halftime as fans? And so we recruited a bunch of young men, and there was a lot of young men that were there that bought into where we were going to be in the future. So the things that I would tell them all the time, I said, now embrace the past. Because when you're at the University of Colorado, and all you hear about is the past, sometimes it can suffocate you as a young man when you're 18 years old, 19 years old, 20, 21. And you're always wanting to try to, you get tired of hearing about it sometimes. So our goal was to embrace the past. And we loved all the former players that came back. We have open arms for them. And it was amazing how each former player would come back and say, hey guys, we've already done our time. We would love to see your legacy start. And so one of our mottos that we talked about is embrace the past and make your own legacy. This is your time. And being here at the Walter Camp is the same way. These young men behind me, you know, they hear the same things at a lot of their schools. They hear the same things about a lot of players, and they embrace the past. But they had to step out in fortitude and work ethic and character and make their own legacy. and carry that high and proud. I'm so honored to be here on the part of our football players, our young men that have battled so hard, our coaching staff. You know, one of the very unique things in today's football is it's transfer at the drop of a hat. You really see it in basketball, too. But the young men on our program, we had the biggest junior-senior class they've had, one of the top two in the history of the school. We had the highest APR, the highest GPA, and we also had the biggest turnaround in the history of the Pac-12 conference of 101 years. And I think all of that... I know that all that goes hand in hand. And we truly tell them all the time, the more you develop as a person, the better player you'll be. You can be a good player for a while, but if you don't keep developing yourself as a person, it'll catch you. And it'll steal your dream of football. So thank you very much. I'd like to, my wife is here, Trisha. We've been married 27 years. She's put up with me that long. And you know, the thing was is, you know, when I was a young kid, I was 13 and I spotted her in junior high. And I tried to get her to go out with me. She wouldn't do it. So finally in high school, I asked her out 3 times in 3 weeks. She turned me down all 3 times. So the 4th week, I said, I'm going out, going again. And she finally went out with me. So I guess I got the lucky end of that stick for sure. But it was that kind of showed you the persistence I have. So well, thank you for everything that Walter Camp stands for. We thank you for the history and what it means to our game. Football has been my life. I grew up as a football coach. I went to football games 9 months before I was born, and it's always been part of what we do. Really appreciate all the hospitality this week. It's been awesome, and I am so honored to put this on my wall at our office and at my house, and really appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Walter Camp selected the first All-America team in 1889. Today, the Walter Camp All-America team is one of the most recognized and prestigious awards in college football. Here is this year's team. The 2016 Walter Camp All-America team is led by Louisville quarterback Lamar Jackson. Joining him in the backfield are two of the country's most prolific running backs, Donnell Pumphrey from San Diego State and Florida State's Dalvin Cook. Oklahoma's Dede Westbrook and East Carolina's Zay Jones are the two receivers, along with tight end Jake Butt from Michigan. And joining the Outland Trophy trio on the offensive line are Florida State's Roderick Johnson and Connor Williams from Texas. On the defensive side of the ball, Florida State's DeMarcus Walker and Tennessee's Derek Barnett headline a stout defensive line. Alabama's Reuben Foster and Vanderbilt's Zach Cunningham anchor the linebackers. Ohio State's Malik Hooker joins the Jim Thorpe Award trio in the secondary. And rounding out the Walter Camp All-America team are the specialists.
All right, stars of the show. Let's meet some All-Americans, shall we? First up, I think we started this end and come on down. Are we? Or are we just randomly here? Okay, we bounce around. Derek Barnett, defensive lineman from Tennessee. Do you know all the words to that song?
Most of it.
Do you want to sing, Rocky Top?
I'm not a good singer.
That's fine. I want to know how a guy your size ends up with number 9.
I asked him, I asked Coach Jones where I came, if I can get that number, and he said yes. And that's the number I wore in high school, so I got lucky.
How do you pick out 9? 9's like a tailback. 9's a quarterback.
I don't know. I thought it looked good, number 9.
Easy enough. Are people in Nebraska scared of you after the bowl game?
I don't think so.
You had you will leave school with 33 sacks, which is the school record at Tennessee, which is going to get more impressive, which breaks the record previously held by Reggie White. What's it mean to do something better than Reggie White?
It's just a great honor just to be my name recognized in the sentence as Reggie White, because he's probably one of the greatest defensive linemen to play the game. So it's really a great honor.
And then as you leave the university, you penned a thank you letter to the fans. What'd you say?
Just thanking all the fans and everybody who put in the hard work, from the training staff, my coaches, and my teammates, and also my mom. She's somewhere around here, but she's done a.
Where is mom? Somebody scream. This is the opposite of the polar ice cap. There she is.
She's done a lot for me, and I've seen her work like 3 jobs when I was a little kid, and her hard work and everlasting love has paid off.
In the NFL, you only have to have 1 job. That'd be terrific. Derek Barnett, ladies and gentlemen, Tennessee. Next up, now we got him, Kendall Beckwith, linebacker, LSU. Okay, so LSU played Missouri this year. I went to that game. Do you know who the leading tackler was in that game?
I think it was myself.
I think it was yourself. That is correct. Do you know how many you had?
I'm not sure.
Okay, well, the second guy had 5. You had 9. So you go ahead and sit down, and we'll move on to the next All-American. No, please. So Leonard Fournette didn't play in your bowl game. A lot of controversy. You didn't play in the bowl game, but why was that?
I have an injury.
What's the injury?
I have a torn ACL.
You're not even limping. How are we doing?
Doing pretty good right now.
The leg is fine. What was it like going through the tumultuous season with all of a sudden halfway through, Coach Miles isn't there anymore?
It was different, you know, but we quickly adjusted, took Coach Ogeron because he had been around, and we just wanted to play for him and win.
I don't know if y'all are familiar with Eddie Ogeron, but can you understand a word the man says? Yeah, that is a thick Cajun accent.
Yeah, I can understand him. Once you've been around him for a while, you start to understand and kind of pick up some of the key words that he says.
Can you do any Coach Ogeron?
I can't do that.
Not even little?
Nah.
Not even gonna go there? He's not here.
He's not.
You don't want to try?
I can't. I can't.
For sure. Because if you don't, I'm gonna have to ask.
Yeah, ask Trey. Trey's pretty good. Yeah.
Trey can do it? Okay. Congratulations. Kendall Beckwith, linebacker, LSU. Next up, a returner, our kicker from Auburn, Daniel Carlson. How you doing, bud? Good to see you again. So we talked a lot of kicking last time you were here. I'm not sure people are familiar with this. You go to Auburn. Your grandfather's a fan of who?
Bama.
And your grandmother's a big fan of who?
Bama.
And your mom went to school where?
Bama.
And your aunts and uncles went to school where?
Bama.
What's the dog's name?
Bama.
I know they're kids, but what the hell happened to you?
I don't know. You know, a lot of red growing up, but somehow ended up at Auburn, and it's obviously been a great experience so far.
A lot to be proud of. I'm going to read this off. Academic All-America, FCA, you work with Children Fighting Cancer. You've helped with holiday toy, clothing, and food drive. You're kind of making us all look bad. How do you find time to do all that and still go to school and play football?
I sleep a little. I don't know. I mean, you know, you find time for what's important. And so, you know, I've been blessed to be where I am. And just, you know, being able to give back a little bit is, you know, something that I think is important.
69 career field goals. By my math, you need how many more to tie the NCAA record? I have it at 27. Yeah, you got 27 in you?
Maybe. We'll see.
Would you lobby Coach like we're ahead? Another touchdown would be poor sportsmanship. Let's go ahead and just kick 3.
I don't know. He likes his offense a lot, so I don't know if he'd buy that.
God bless Gus. Thanks, man. Appreciate it. Daniel Carlson. Next up, running back from Florida State, Dalvin Cook. I always like to go ahead and show the people your plaque again. And I always want to know, can you tell what game that was?
Syracuse.
How'd you do?
Pretty good.
Pretty good sign. You are the single season rushing record at Florida State. Do you know whose record you broke?
Yeah, he's sitting over there.
You are the career rushing record holder at Florida State. You know whose record you broke?
He's here.
But you're not mad, are you, Warren? No, not at all. Why would you want to be mad at him? So, is he good to you?
Great. Great person. You know, great on the field. You know, the things he do with the community and stuff. So, you know, he always give me courage to the game. So, you know, I commend him for it.
Mentor. Why are you leaving then? You got records. You got eligibility.
It's time for me to pass the torch to the younger guys. You know, I did what I had to do at a university. You know, I gave everything I had to give, so I got to pass the torch now.
Good way to go out. Why was the Orange Bowl special?
You know, I was home, down in my hometown. You know, it was one of my big dreams to play in the hometown, my last game. So, you know, I just gave it all I had.
Very good. Thank you very much. Dalvin Cook, the man who erased work done from the record books. Next, it's Zach Cunningham, linebacker from Vanderbilt. Zach led the SEC in tackles, and most of the headlines are, you were the best linebacker nobody knows about. What should we know about Zach?
What should we know about me? I'm not sure. What is there to know about me? Coming into Vanderbilt, I redshirted my first year. That next year, I didn't start. I was a backup linebacker. The year after that, the year I was first team All-SEC, I was a backup linebacker until the starter ahead of me got hurt. That was like the third game.
What does anchor down mean?
Gird your loins. it's a term that I kind of grew into as, you know, coming into Vanderbilt. You know, anchoring down basically like, you know, get together, you know, pull the, like the very last, drop of energy that you have in you. You know, go out there and fight.
Yeah, gird your loins isn't a good bumper sticker. Anchor down's much better. I'd go with that. You going to stay or are you going to go? The NFL's calling.
I'm thinking about leaving, yeah. I'm going to be going.
Have you made that decision official yet, or are we just – okay. So we're kind of like this 900 closest friends of yours are the first to know?
not the very first to know, no.
Well, don't sign anything just yet. Before I let you go, you and Daniel got a little bit of a history, right? Daniel missed one kick inside of 50 yards all season. Everything else he missed was over 50 yards. Can you explain how it is he missed the field goal?
That game of Vanderbilt versus Auburn, I decided to go and jump over the line to block a field goal, and that's the one field goal he missed inside 50.
Okay, so here's the thing. Here's your assignment, your homework after you're done. Go Google this game, Auburn-Vanderbilt. The man jumped over the entire line, timed it right, got there, and literally could have kicked it before Daniel. That's how close it was. It's fantastic, and you're going to go, that guy is a freak athlete, and I was there the night he told everybody he went pro. Thanks, everybody. Very good. Thanks, Zach. Up next, from West Virginia, defensive back Rasul Douglas. All right, here's our man, Rasul. He is, by the way, I don't know if you know, we are thick with defensive backs up here. Really good attendance from our defensive backs. So I'd have a little closer. It's all right. By the way, are you in man coverage here, or are you going to drop into a zone?
I'm in man coverage.
Darn right he is. He's a good. Why would anybody want to play defensive back in the Big 12? They chuck the magic bean every down.
I just figured it was a passing lead and to show that I can cover being a 6'2", 6'3 guy. I figured the Big 12 would be the best position for me.
Mm-hmm. But that's taken on a big challenge. You got to have a short memory because every once in a while they're going to complete one.
Yeah, definitely. They're going to complete a lot. I mean, Tony Gibson, he blitzes every play, so we're either in one or zero.
How's a guy from New Jersey end up in Morgantown?
Went out to junior college, and I met Coach Mitchell, and he was a great guy and mentor. And when he recruited me, it wasn't just about football. It was more family, what to do after football, like when everything is over. So I just decided to go with him and be a
D1 is glamorous, right? Every game's on TV. The weight rooms are great. The training table is stacked. Community college is a tough go. How'd you make it through there in Nassau?
I don't even know. I know one day I woke up and quit and came back a week later. It was just horrible, worst experience.
Why'd you stick with it?
Family, kind of struggling. I knew it was up to me to make it, so I had to go back.
Rasul Douglas, West Virginia. Congratulations. Next up, defensive back from Alabama, Micah Fitzpatrick. That's this year?
Yes, sir.
Did you score?
Yes, sir.
When was it? Oh, that's against the Hogs, huh?
Yeah, yes, sir. Against Arkansas.
Who are you pointing at?
The quarterback. I was telling Eddie to go and block him because I don't know if he saw him or not.
Okay, so you weren't rubbing it in. It was like, just make sure. Yeah, that's embarrassing. You get tackled by the quarterback.
Yeah, yes, sir. He didn't tackle me, though.
Yeah, you can't handle that. I'm going to make this quick and painless and rip off the Band-Aid. How you doing after Monday night?
I'm good. You know, Clemson's a great team, and we played a great game, so it's all good.
But do you hate Deshaun Watson just even a little bit, maybe?
Nah, I don't hate him. You know, he's a great player. He's going to make some great plays, so, you know, it's a lot of fun competing against him.
But your coach said your defense, he said, I love my defense because they're hateful guys. But now he meant that in a very nice way, so maybe you can explain that to the people why that was a very good compliment from the coach.
You know, I just don't like when people score on us and make big plays on us, so we just try and affect the other team as much as we can, being physical with them and flying to the ball.
I like to usually check the players' Twitter because they're good for something. Here's what I found out about Minka. His mom is a ferocious tweeter, right? She has got your back.
Yeah, you know, she sees some things where fans will tweet something crazy at me. You know, I tell her not to say anything, but she don't listen to me. And, and you know, she tells me that she's protective and all that. But, you know, I try and tell her to calm down. But I'm her baby boy, so, you know, she's going to try and have my back.
She did say you have your father, Minka Sr.'s, patience.
Yeah, yes, sir. Because, you know, I don't let that stuff get to me. I just brush it off and keep it moving.
All right. I thought maybe you're pointing at mom. Just one day it's going to be out there in the NFL. Have you thought about who you'd like to cover?
Whoever's in front of me. You know, it don't matter to me. Whoever's in front of me.
That's easy enough. Congratulations. Thank you, sir. Minka Fitzpatrick, Alabama. Next, we have Quadri Henderson, kick returner from Pittsburgh. So you all beat Clemson.
Yep.
What's that make you guys?
Still Pittsburgh, you know. We just went in there and beat a great team.
What were you thinking Monday night when you were watching that?
Man, we beat them.
That's simple. This year, 4 returns for touchdown. That is a dangerous occupation. Why would anybody want to do that?
It's fun back there. You know, just go back there, have patience, read your blockers, and spring free when you see a hole.
But a lot of times they don't block. You're just all by yourself. I was talking to your SID earlier, like, the punter even has a personal protector, but they just put you back there and go, have at it.
You know, it's special teams, not like high school, where you just catch the ball and just run back across the field until you find the hole. Coach Powell, he preaches special teams every day in meetings. You know, we go in there, we got certain people to block, and we just go in there and execute.
You also were in a game with Syracuse that ended 76-61. What was that about?
I don't even know, man. That was probably the longest game I ever played in, but I don't know what all that was about.
I mean, do you look up that and go, 70? That's not a football score.
Yeah, it was like 50-something, like 30 in the third quarter. Like, man, we got another quarter of this.
Before I let you go, there are two guys in the history of Pitt football that have a season with more than 2,000 yards from scrimmage. You and Tony Dorsett. Tony was here, participated in all the activities with the Walter Camp Football Foundation, as he usually does. He had to leave tonight because he's got to be at the Cowboys-Packer game tomorrow because he's being honored, and I guess you should show up for that too. But what's it mean to be in that company?
You know, that's just a blessing to have my name in the same sense as Tony Dorsett. You know, he was one of the greats for the Cowboys, and, you know, just go out there and, you know, do my thing, get over 2,000 yards is a blessing.
And you're in good Pitt company, right? Jim Colvert's out here and Coach Ditka.
Yes, sir. Hail to Pitt.
All right. Is there a Pitt saying I should know that, you know, we can cheer going out?
Hail to Pitt.
It's not terribly original, but it works. Go Pitt. Thanks. Rob Kaufman wants me to keep talking to him because he's like, I'm as tall as that guy. Harold Landry is next, defensive lineman, Boston College. That's all right. This issue too?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Deshaun Watson. That guy just keeps coming up all the time, doesn't it? On consecutive weekends, you had to chase Dalvin Cook, and then you had to chase Lamar Jackson. What was that like?
You know, two great players. Lamar, he like a snake. He could definitely know how to slither out of tackles. Dalvin Cook, he's got a great mixture of power and speed. Two great athletes. I look forward to those challenges, though, so, you know.
Did you get a hold of him?
I did.
That's good. Good for you. People want to brag about the SEC, right? But the ACC, that is tough sledding this year.
Yeah, it was. There's a lot of great talent in the ACC. You know, people love the SEC. You know, they got a bunch of great athletes, obviously, representing here. But, you know, the ACC, I think they're best conference in the nation. So,
Florida State and Louisville both beat you, and yet you come back three straight wins. How important was that?
You know, it meant a lot to our program. You know, everybody thought that it was going downhill from there, but the players and the coaches, we made a decision to flip the page and keep it pushing, and we got it done.
And you've made your decision, too, about next year, and it's not the NFL. Why are you coming back?
I think there's some areas in my game that I can improve on, and I plan on getting those done this offseason and proving it to scouts during the season.
Good. We'll save your seat back here, and you come back next year. Harold Landry. Oh. One of these guys is going to slip up, and I'm going to take it home. Jordan Lewis, defensive back, Michigan. If we could not do the interview and just listen to the fight song, would that be cool with you?
Yeah, that's fine.
I love the fight song, but I want to talk to you. First off, did that Ohio State kid make the first down?
No.
Not even close?
No, not close at all.
We can't rectify that now, can we?
Nope.
By the way.
They didn't bring out the change, so, I mean.
Because I talked to Eddie George in Orlando, and they said, no, he made it by a lot.
Nah, it was the angle he was watching TV.
Could have been. Yeah, I guess you had to be there. You have the career record at Michigan, right? And they've got some guys that have played defensive back. When you talk about Trip Welburn or Charles Woodson or Dave Brown, nobody has more career pass breakups than you with 44. Tell me why a pass breakup is actually better than an interception.
You get to go do it again on the next play.
Line them up. If I'm in a draft this year, do I want you or do I want Jabril Peppers?
You going to do that?
I am. I'm going to do that.
He's a great player, but I mean, me probably.
Would you like to play like 80 different positions?
Of course.
Yeah. Well, then how come Coach Harbaugh is holding you back?
You got to ask him.
Tell me about that guy. He makes some headlines.
Oh, no, I'm not going to say anything to him.
Nothing at all? How about this? How about, just give me, do you have a favorite saying that he uses or a favorite story about him?
Enthusiasm unknown to mankind. That's pretty much his saying. And we live by that every day. As you see, we went down there in Miami in practice all day. So, yeah, we live by that. So.
Jordan Lewis, everybody. Thanks, man. Oh, now we got a big'un. Cody O'Connell, offensive lineman, Washington State. If you actually stand on the chair, then you might have it. Yeah. That's perfect. Okay, so Coach Harbaugh is great, but we want to short shift Coach Leach, because that guy, he's a small bit of crazy too, isn't he?
No comment.
What, is he going to take playing time away? It's hard to find good offensive linemen. You'll be fine.
I'm not saying anything, no.
All right. Do you ever watch and listen to his interviews?
Yeah, he resembles Marks a lot.
And then do you just shake your head?
Yeah.
All right. That you are here is a bit of a surprise, because let's go through your career. Your first year on campus as a freshman, you?
Sat in the stands.
Redshirted. And then your redshirt freshman year, you're with the team, and you played how much?
Zero.
None. Hard to miscount zero. Then the next year, you're on the field for?
Field goal.
Field goals. Some kickwa. So this is the first time this year that you're off playing the offensive line, and you end up as All-American. How did that happen?
Maybe someone messed up somewhere.
We should all mess up that great. What was the difference? What was the change? What was the opportunity, I guess?
Really, I just got my – I saw a chance to step out on that field, and you know, I just took it and just played my heart out, and this is where I'm at.
What's it feel like when you just maul another guy?
Well, I mean, I'm bigger, so I probably should do that to most people. So it feels pretty good, and you know, all your hard work's paying off.
I'm all right with that. Slow start, and the finish wasn't quite what we wanted, but what were the 8 glorious weeks in between there like?
You know, they were fun, just playing one game a week and just having fun. Yeah.
Okay, so we've gone from not playing to All-American, and next year I can expect what?
Great season. We're bringing a lot of guys back, so I'm expecting a lot, but you know, we got to get there first, get through the offseason.
And you got a coach who likes Pirates. There you go. Terrific. Thank you, Cody.
Thank you.
He just shook my hand, and I'm going to need a cast. Tre'Davious White, defensive back, LSU. You're a defensive back. What are you doing with the ball in your hands right there?
I try to get as much as I can. I played quarterback in high school, so I love the ball.
Do you miss playing quarterback? Because every once in a while, LSU's had some quarterback issues. We'd like to have a guy. Why not get over to that side of the ball?
Nah, not so much. I like to cover receivers.
All right. Because so much of this night is about me, against Missouri, 3 tackles, 2 defenses, 2 pass defense, and a pick, so I kind of hate you. Show the folks again real quick. Well, it's hidden. He wears number 18. Why is 18 significant at LSU?
It's the total leader of the team. A selfless guy that sort of leads by example. Just try to do all the little things right. So, you know, the little things make the biggest difference. So I just try to, you know, take the younger guys under my wings and just show them the ropes like guys before me did.
So when you're gone, will you watch who has 18 and make sure he knows that responsibility?
I get a vote.
You do?
Yeah, I get a vote, yeah. So I get a say in that.
Who's in line?
I can't say right now.
I watch a lot of college football. Alabama's got hateful guys. Michigan, every guy in their defense made all conference. And you guys are salty too. So if I need protection getting out of here, do I need your defense, Bama, or Michigan? Come on.
LSU.
Why?
Got a great front 7, got elite defensive backs, so I feel like we have the best defense in the country.
Good. And now tell me what, give me some Eddie Orgeron.
Hold up.
Go Tigers.
And what can you translate your Eddie Orgeron?
It's hard, man.
What did he say there? What did you just say, going to practice?
No, he tried to say go Tigers.
He said try to go, let me hear it again.
Go Tigers.
Thank goodness he's not here. Thank you very much, brother. Tre'Davious White, LSU. Next up, from Texas, another good fight song. Offensive lineman, Connor Williams. there's a very famous cricket player from India named Connor Williams. Do you guys ever get confused?
Apparently, because the wiki page is half me, half him, and then half a ex-Utah DN.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah, you can't trust what's on wiki. I'm going to put out then that you never were class president. Some of these things I read. No. You have on your Twitter, there's your name, and then it says, "We all have our story, leave a legacy." Start with the first one. What's your story?
I mean, I was bullied when I was little, but I just think it's amazing that everybody around us just have like where they come from, you know, and it just means a lot to me to hear everybody's story and just the path I've been on. I'm very blessed to be where I am.
You were bullied when you were little because you were big.
Yeah, very big.
And now big is okay.
apparently.
And what's the legacy you'd like to leave?
I mean, I just want to represent well for the O-line for Texas, and then I mean, whatever I can do, I want to leave a legacy.
Got a new coach at Texas. You got some years to play. What are your thoughts on Coach Herman?
I'm very excited about him. He brings a new energy, and I mean, it's gonna be a job.
Do you think you could wrestle Bevo to the ground?
Maybe a new baby one, because we got a new one this year.
So just a little small one?
Yeah.
Okay. And you're playing what position?
Left tackle.
Left tackle is where the money is. So hang on and get to know Connor. Thanks, brother. Connor Williams. Oh, I love these guys. We got the punter now from Utah, Mitch Wishnowski. All right. You were the third straight cat from Utah to win the Ray Guy Award. That Hackett's a tough act to follow. How'd you do that?
I don't know. I see Tommy all the time back home, so Tommy helped me out and stuff like that. So he's a good mentor for me out there.
Could I make a case that the most valuable player on the special teams for Utah is Chase Dominguez?
Definitely. He's won the Ray Guy Award 3 times, twice with Tommy, once with me. So he's the common denominator in the group.
Tell him who Chase Dominguez is.
Chase is our snapper.
He's the long snapper. Otherwise, nothing happens. By the way, the accent, I can't place it. New Jersey, Texas?
Australia.
Australia. What is the punting thing you got going down there?
We just play Aussie rules football, so we punt a lot. And we got two blokes, Nathan Chapman and Johnny Smith at Pro Kick Australia, that just send boys over. So they sent Tommy over, they sent me over, and now we're pretty much at all the big schools.
And you're from Perth, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. Because most people, we're not probably that skilled in Australian geography. Could you punt a ball from Perth to Sydney?
I don't know about that. Well, I could give it a crack.
It's 2,000 miles. 2,044 miles. Your average is 48 yards a kick. Do you know how many kicks it would take to get from Perth to Melbourne? Because I do.
57.
74,947 punts from Perth to Sydney. Little less if you want to kick the ball to Melbourne. Real quick, everybody here, we grew up, and most of our sporting heroes are football. How about yours in Australia?
Oh, sporting hero. I played soccer most of my life, so I was a big Man United fan, so I love Cristiano Ronaldo growing up.
Oh, you and him, your hair is perfect. Fantastic. Mitch, thank you. Thanks. Thank you very much. We'll see him back next year, or at least someone else from down under. Now, as is tradition here at the Walter Camp dinner, the youngster who is at the head of the table is the head of the All-American class, and he gets to talk last. It is time to meet the player of the year. You're probably familiar with his quarterback stylings. You might even recall the beautiful crushed red velvet jacket he wore to the Heisman ceremony. I just want you to know, I had the blazer first. I showed it to him. If everybody wants to see the picture, it was fantastic. We wore it Christmas Eve. To present the 2016 Walter Camp Player of the Year Award, please welcome the Camp Foundation's president-elect, Donald Trump. No. That was so cheap. Mike Madera.
Thank you, John. From his first game this year as a sophomore at Louisville,
where he accounted for 8 touchdowns in the first half alone, Lamar Jackson has created an amazing highlight reel. At this time, we ask you to direct your attention to the video screens at either end of the hall.
Explosive, evasive, elusive. In coach speak, twitchy. You can't tackle, but you can't touch. Familiar plays run at freakish tempo. Lean, long limb, with strength to create 770 rushing yards after contact. Lamar's gifts as a thrower became viral legend long ago, but this year's growth as a passer makes him most proud. More polish in the pocket, command of an ever-expanding playbook. Still scratching the surface of his skill set, but already smashing records.
As talented as Lamar is, he will tell you his mom, Felicia Jones, has been the driving force behind his success. Always there for support, but also there to give constructive criticism. She taught Lamar not only to be the best that he could be, but to be better than the rest. And this year, he certainly was. Lamar passed for over 3,500 yards, ran for over 1,400 yards, and threw 30 touchdowns. Jackson led Louisville during the year to a number 3 ranking, their highest in 10 years. This year, Lamar won the Maxwell Award and became the youngest player ever to win the Heisman. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me as the Walter Camp Football Foundation presents the Player of the Year Award to Lamar Jackson.
Good evening. Well, I don't really have too much to say. You know, I just want to thank, you know, the president, you know, for giving me this tremendous award. And I want to thank you to behalf of my teammates down in Louisville. You know, they couldn't be here. You know, it's an individual award, I guess. And it was a lot of things going on this year. You know, a lot of people down our team, you know, not expecting us to be, you know, good teams. You know, we fell short to Clemson, but we fell short a lot, actually, last 3 games of the season. But, you know, it's all about my teammates, man. I don't really like to, you know, be a selfish player because I don't feel I make it this far without them guys. So I just like to thank my team, my coaches, you know, the training staff, and the whole Louisville fan base, you know. Go Cards.
I'm just going to put this up real quick. I don't know if they can zoom in on that or not. You see that? That's me in my red jacket that I bought before Lamar Jackson wore it at the Heisman. Look good on both of us, that's what I'm going to say. Tell me the best part of this season.
You know, it was hard. You know, it was a lot of ups and downs during the season. I don't really feel like we had a great, great mark of the season. I don't really know yet.
What's it like to hear your name called when they say the Heisman Trophy?
It's amazing, you know, just for me being able to have my name called with all the other, you know, former Heisman Trophy winners, great guys. It's a tremendous achievement for me.
Is it true, you said, as a freshman, the playbook really wasn't your thing?
No, it wasn't at all.
How do you quarterback a team if you're not really enjoying the playbook?
God-given ability. God first.
But isn't it important guys sort of know where they're going?
Well, you know, I wouldn't say I didn't know the whole playbook. You know, I knew certain things, but I just didn't know what a quarterback should know, you know, to be the field general. And, you know, my sophomore year, I tuned it up a little bit. You know, I hit the film room a lot, so I was able to, you know, contribute to the team.
He just tore it up a little bit. So what's next year and beyond?
Oh, we trying to win the national championship.
Goals as a player. Once you got a Heisman, I mean, that's a standard.
improving my game, try to perfect my craft. You know, it's never too much room for improvement. You always got to work hard and you try to be the best at what you do.
And you got to measure yourself. The ACC, that's tough.
Yeah, very. A lot of great teams in the ACC.
Lamar Jackson, your Walter Camp Football Foundation Player of the Year. Now, someday, Lamar, you're going to sit in a job interview with a potential employer, and he's going to say, where do you see yourself in 5 years? And it's okay if you don't know the answer to that, but tell him, you know, in 2041, for sure, you're going to be back here at Yale celebrating your silver anniversary as a Walter Camp All-American. David Fulcher, where's David? Come hither. It's you. Besides David, we're inviting all returning alumni here with us at the dinner tonight to come up to the dais, join the Alumni Association president, Mr. Fulcher, as we celebrate 50 years in this hall and recognize the 25th reunion alumni. That's the 1991 All-America team who are celebrating their Walter Camp silver anniversary. So come on up, everybody.
Thank you. Before I do this, give me a second here. I will try to introduce everybody as possible. Walter Camp is a very special thing. My wife Judy and I, we've been here 17 years since I was an All-American, and we enjoy coming back. Each year to celebrate the new All-American teams and participate with them in the weekend events along with all the alumni. For the 50th Walter Camp Dinner Weekend, we've had a great response, as you can see, from the All-Americans and the former award winners. The Walter Camp Weekend gives us an opportunity to get together, renew friendships, and participate with the foundation. Our Thursday night alumni dinner, the Friday media brunch, the stay-in-school rally, the hospital visits, the high school breakfast of champions, and the All-American Youth Clinics provide a backdrop of rewarding activities leading up to this, our main celebration. We're happy to be back and blessed to have each other. First, I would like to recognize those alumni who participated earlier with us but had to leave due to other personal commitments. Those guys are Joe Andruzzi, Kajana Carter, Nico, and I knew I was going to mess this name up. Nico, I'm sorry. Nico played at Purdue. Best thing I can do there. Tony Rice from Notre Dame, George Rogers, and Tony Dorsett. Those guys obviously couldn't be here, but yet they were here with us. And of course, I'd like to thank those guys who are here tonight. So these guys are coming up. Morton Anderson, come on up. Aaron Beasley. Gil Bryant, Donald Brown, Tim Brown, Drew Butler, Kevin Butler, Jim Colbert, Iron Mike Ditka, Eddie George, Ken Huff, Ed King, Orlando Pace, Paul Palmer, Mike Ruth, Tarek Salah, Corey Sawyer, Ronnie Stanley, Ron Simmons, Art Steele, probably the best tight end that I didn't get a chance to play against, but Kellen Winslow, Donnell Wolford, and Chris Zorge. Come on up, guys.
Oh, they're there.
They're already there. I like that. Now, also, as these guys are up here, I'd like to now give special recognition to our silver anniversary alumni who were named Walter Camp All-Americans 25 years ago. That is Desmond Howard, Marvin Jones, Greg Stepanek, and Durrell Williams.
Silver anniversary guys, come down.
John, take control, John.
I'm doing the best I can.
Okay.
You want to take the picture first?
I'm going to take the picture right here. Straight ahead. You got this.
You good? On behalf of the Silver Anniversary Award winners, first I'd like for you guys to hold your applause. I need to acknowledge two things tonight. First is the outstanding job of our MC, John Anderson, and the chefs in the back, because those potatoes were just outstanding. Round of applause for the potatoes and John Anderson, ladies and gentlemen. Great job by our chefs in the back and our MC. I'm very honored to represent this group, to be here tonight. I haven't been here in 25 years, so it's still a very special dinner. I'd like to say congratulations to the Player of the Year, Lamar Jackson, and to the other student athletes behind us. Give yourselves a round of applause. You guys had a fantastic year. We had just an incredible national championship game, didn't we? Boy, I tell you what, it's nothing like that student-athlete entertainment, right? Best that money can buy. You guys have a great evening. Thank you again, and appreciate the acknowledgement and recognition. Coach McIntyre, thanks for sharing that story, how you begged your wife to finally go out with you 4 or 5 times. So, guys, there's always hope. Guys, there's hope out there, okay? It's what to be resilient, Coach. And congratulations, though, on the Coach of the Year honor. You well deserve. And thank you, guys, and go Blue.
Yeah, Coach, that was even a bigger turnaround than the Colorado thing this year. So we'll let our guys go by and find their seats again. Can I just tell you how cool it is that Kellen Winslow here? Because I've been holding up the Missouri banner for so long, and finally to have somebody else help me lift it up. And I'll tell you this about Kellen Winslow. I have had the pleasure of being at his Hall of Fame induction in the Pro Football Hall of Fame in Canton. And then he spoke one time back when I was there at the University of Missouri. And as players, you're all success. And beyond that, if you can be like Kellen and strive to be a person of value beyond that, you will have accomplished great things in your life. Silver and gold at the same time. By the way, David Fulcher, Walter Camp All-America team, 1985, is that right? Wow. Because 1885, you'd have been on one of the earlier ones. But you're still extra old. But again, he is proof, as most of these guys, that when we celebrate the guys back here this year, but it really becomes a lifetime achievement award. David is also a winner of our next award. Mike St. Clair, head of long-term care insurance sales at Mass Mutual Financial Group, is here to present the 2016 Walter Camp Football Foundation Alumni of the Year Award.
As a child growing up in Ohio, Orlando Pace set a goal of one day being in the Pro Football Hall of Fame. Big dreams for a little kid. Well, Orlando was never that little. And so begins the legend of Orlando Pace. Orlando always knew he was blessed, and the positive influences of his cousin and his mother allowed him to stay self-motivated and on the path to college. Pace began his career at Ohio State University and was only the second true freshman to start on opening day for the Buckeyes. The term pancake block may have originated in the 1980s. However, Orlando Pace perfected it, and he did not allow a sack in his last 2 years at Ohio State. He won the Outland Trophy and is the only player to have won the Lombardi Award twice. Pace was also named twice to the Walter Camp All-America team, is a member of the Walter Camp All-Century team, and was inducted into the College Football Hall of Fame in 2013. Orlando was drafted first overall in the 1997 draft by the St. Louis Rams. the first offensive lineman to do so since 1968. During his 13-year pro football career, he would start 154 consecutive games. He was named to 7 consecutive Pro Bowls and won a Super Bowl in 1999 with the greatest show on turf. The fact is, the greatest show may have never existed without Pace at left tackle. When the list of the best offensive linemen of all time is discussed, there is one name rising to the top every time: Orlando Pace. In 2016, Pace was inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame, a childhood dream comes true. It is my pleasure to present the Walter Camp Football Foundation Alumni of the Year Award to Orlando Pace.
Good evening. It's such an honor to be here today accepting this award. In 1995, I was selected to the Walter Camp Football All-American team. And at 20 years old, you don't get a full appreciation of what that team means and all the great things that the volunteers of the Walter Camp, all the volunteers that do so much, the presidents, the community, and what it's really about. Fast forward 20 years from now, I have an opportunity to come back and accept this great honor, but I really got a different appreciation for what it's really about. It's really about community. Not many Hall of Fame teams value their community the way that Walter Camp does here in Connecticut, and all the great things that they do that go unnoticed. I'd like to thank Robert Kaufman for all his work and making this event possible. I was just talking to David Fulcher a little earlier, and we were talking about when you're 21 years old, and I could remember coming, and it was such an honor for us to be selected to this team, and I couldn't wait to get here. And I know my teammate Eddie George is here, and we still laugh about those memories that we had, because there's one particular story, and there's a host here who reminded me of that story before. And it was just funny, we were thinking the same thing every time we see each other, the memories and the camaraderie that we build. There were so many guys that I played with that was on that team that's in attendance here today. And I just wanted to say thank you guys. We created a lot of memories, and hopefully we can continue. Secondly, I'd like to congratulate all of the 2016 Hall of Fame team. Hopefully you guys will understand what this weekend is about, a sense of community and pride. So I'd like to say you guys had an awesome year and continued success in your future endeavors. In closing, thank you guys. I'd like to thank all the sponsors too. I know you guys have worked. I had the opportunity to sit at the table with you guys last night, and I told them it was a great, great table to sit at. We had a great time. We laughed. So thank you to all the sponsors for the Walter Camp as well. And I know Desmond said, go blue. Let's go Bucks.
Orlando Pace is listed in the game program, slightly larger than Rob Kaufman. He's 6'7", 325. But you don't have to be physically imposing to be the bigger person. Sometimes you just have to be a loving grandma. To present the Walter Camp American Hero Award for 2016, please welcome Walter Camp Football Foundation Treasurer, past President Bill Raffone.
A hero is a person who is admired for courage, outstanding achievements, or noble qualities. Tonight, we honor an individual who embodies all of these attributes. Sandra Adams is a woman who has stood courageously through tragedy, pushed on through adversity, and persevered in the face of challenge. As we celebrate our Walter Camp Golden Anniversary Dinner this evening. We welcome and celebrate an outstanding woman, mother, and grandmother who truly has a heart of gold. On November 16, 1999, Sandra Adams' daughter, Sharika, 24 years old and 8 months pregnant, was gunned down by a hired assassin, resulting in both tragedy and triumph. Miraculously surviving it to make to the hospital, doctors were able to save Sharika's baby boy. But tragically, Sharika died 4 weeks later. The baby, Chancellor Lee Adams, who's here tonight, Chancellor was born with cerebral palsy as a result of the oxygen deprivation caused by the shooting. Told he will never walk, talk. His grandmother, G-Mom, Sandra Adams, better get that right, has dedicated her life to her only grandson, Lee. Please listen and observe as Brian Gumbel tells us her story.
It's a tragedy on so many levels, and it was also very, very unnecessary. Ray Carruth was a wide receiver with the Carolina Panthers. He impregnated this young girl. Rather than deal with it as a normal person might, he hired some people to kill her. We're left with a child mentally and physically challenged as a result of the murder of his mom. His grandmother, she's very giving and she's very forgiving. She does not want him to grow up thinking his father was the monster that you or I might. I think once you see his smile, I can't imagine anyone would not find a degree of sympathy for this young man.
When we first met Chancellor Lee Adams, he was 12 going on 13, but a preteen in name only. Suffering from cerebral palsy, he needed assistance to walk and had little cognitive ability. But today, almost 4 years later, the strides he has made are remarkable to him. And the never-ending love and support of the grandmother he calls G-Mom.
This young man, he is so dedicated, so focused. He puts his whole heart into his therapy and everything, 100%.
Push again, Lee.
That's it, Lee!
Come on, man.
Oh, good.
He's 13. How's he compared to others his age?
He's definitely not on a level of a typical 13-year-old. He's still more at the elementary stages in life. As he gets older, the gap gets wider and wider, you see.
He's not just mine. He came through Sharika, but he came through her for the world to make a great impact. I see him already in his calling, going out and speaking to groups of people about not being bitter and getting better, and about forgiveness and how you thrive through forgiving others. His life is a message to many of the young people today and older ones of just unconditional love.
I expect that Chancellor will gain enough knowledge educationally that he can have some degree of independence.
So when I read that you say, I think he's on the road to full recovery,
mm-hmm.
Am I hearing your heart or your head?
You're hearing my heart. I think when you have love in your heart, mm-hmm. when you got lots of love, it overcomes almost any tragedy. So I think when you glean the positive things that happen from anything in life, that you can move forward triumphantly and you can always be a winner.
It is my privilege to present the Walter Camp Football Foundation 2016, American hero, a great American, a winner who conquers all with love, perseverance, and forgiveness, Sandra Adams.
Everyone, first and foremost, I want to give all thanks and praises to God for just orchestrating everything for my good and allowing me to be here at this great celebration today. Alec. I'd like to thank Rob Kaufman for being obedient to his spirit when he saw our story and decided to reach out to me to offer me this wonderful award. And thank you to the board of directors at Walter Camp, to the alumni, all of the staff, all of the honorees today, the sponsors, anybody, the volunteers especially too, and anybody that's associated with this wonderful organization, thank you for giving me the honor to be here tonight. I stand before you tonight not thinking that I'm a hero at all. I think I'm a grandmom that would just do what she is supposed to do in the face of tragedy. And as I've read and learned more about this great Walter Camp organization, the things that I found that this organization is founded and lives upon is self-denial, commitment, and that is commitment to excellence also, and the sense of dedication. So even though I don't feel that I'm a hero, I am so humbled and honored to receive this award, not only on my behalf, but number one, on behalf of my daughter, Sharika Adams. She exhibited such strength and such courage. She always wanted to be a great mom, and there was no other time than in that very moment that she showed forth the qualities of what a dedicated, excellent mom was. So this award is first and foremost for Sharika and then for my grandson, Chancellor. Walter Camp Foundation, I hear resounding over and over the practice of just dedication, and all these young men here tonight have just exhibited such dedication and hard work and effort, and that is exactly what my grandson exhibits every day. In the midst of all that he has to overcome, he does it with the most magnificent smile and such a pure and loving heart. And so one thing I do know for sure is that in the midst of tragedy, when you have a firm foundation to stand upon, which is your strong faith, and you have hope and love in your heart, your future can be as bright as you want it to be,
And so we don't ever look for pity for Chancellor because he is what some people call disabled. I tell him every day that he is not disabled. He is abled differently. And my main message is one of forgiveness, that each and every one of us have the opportunity to practice in our daily lives, because none of us are perfect. And we know in teamwork, we're only as strong as our weakest link. So let's not put our fellow man down and talk badly about them when they come up short. We are separated. We separate our who from our do. Sometimes we do the wrong things. We make the wrong decisions. But that's not at our core who we are. So let's all learn to be a little more forgiving with our brothers and sisters, and let's walk hand in hand in love. Thank you again for this award.
And just kind of a small takeoff of Jim Valvano's famous speech. If I could smile like that kid just once a day, that would be a full day for all of us. Fantastic. Man of the Year, that seems like a very cool title. So you have to follow Grandmother of the Century. Tough draw, Warwick. To present the 2016 Man of the Year Award, here is Walter Camp Vice President Mario Coppola.
Certainly a tough act to follow. Have you ever felt isolated, alone, in need of inspiration or hope? Work Done knows that feeling. He also knows how to turn tragedy into triumph. At 18 years old, while most of us would be looking forward to the future, personal tragedy forced Work Done to stop and raise his siblings. Later at Florida State University, Work left defenders standing still as he weaved around and through his opponents. He was named All-ACC three times, won a national championship in 1993, and later had his number retired at Florida State University. Dunn was drafted 12th overall by the Tampa Bay Buccaneers and went on to win the AP Offensive Rookie of the Year Award and would be named to the Pro Bowl three times during his career. At this time, please direct your attention to the screens at either end of the hall.
People had the question, I mean, what's this little guy going to do?
Hit it, Ward! Hit it, Ward! Hit it!
Early handoff to Dunn. Dunn pops, weaves, deals, and wheels. Hits outside. Breaks for the 25, 30 sideline.
At 5'9", Warwick Dunn was a little man who made a big first impression in the NFL.
Little inside handoff on a delay to Dunn. Dunn breaks the tackle. Dunn tries to get out there. Dunn's got the corner. The little guy does it again.
Warwick Dunn just put on a showcase where everyone said, okay, this guy here is going to be a superstar.
Not surprisingly that Warwick makes this list. His height was probably his advantage. His low center of gravity, you know, he could hit the hole standing up sometime.
He faked out how many? Maybe 7 Green Bay Packers?
Never got a clean shot on Warwick.
Looked like he's getting ready to get hit, head on train wreck, and all of a sudden, he just steps to the side and the guy falls on his face.
In 1997, Dunn was named the NFL's Offensive Rookie of the Year and went on to the Pro Bowl twice as a Buccaneer.
I think the Bucs finally figured out his toughness. They didn't have to worry about his size.
Warwick Dunn leaving his ground!
That's all heart and soul, number 28.
So at some point, they quit counting his number of touches and started counting their blessings that they had drafted this guy.
Warwick Dunn is a special running back.
You gotta grind this thing out. We want this game to come down to us, all right?
In 2002, our number 8 shortest player moved to the Atlanta Falcons, where he earned another trip to the Pro Bowl.
Because he was out to prove that he was the man.
He played with a chip on his shoulder, but this was really a place where he found himself as a great football player.
90 yards, the longest run in Atlanta Falcon history.
I really didn't even get tired on that.
On his climb to the top, our number 8 shortest player faced towering obstacles. When he was 18, his mother, a Baton Rouge police officer, was killed during a robbery.
You don't ever want to get a call in the middle of the night saying someone that is pretty much your world is gone. She molded me, and I had 18 years and 2 days with her to be the type of man I am today.
To honor his mother, Dunn established Homes for the Holidays, where the little man made a huge impact by helping single moms and their families purchase homes.
You know, you talk about someone having a lasting effect on a family. He's just very, very, very unique. You don't find many Warwick Dunns in this world.
I admire the guy for what he's done throughout his career on the field, but more so off the field, because the guy is a great citizen.
You just have to rub your eyes and say, this guy's just too good to be true.
Work Done the Philanthropist has received many awards of recognition, including the Walter Payton Man of the Year Award, the Heisman Humanitarian Award, the Bart Starr Award, and the Jefferson Award for Outstanding Athlete in Service and Philanthropy. He's the founder of the Work Done Charities and co-founder of many other Athletes for Hope. Our video started with people had to question, what's this little guy going to do? Well, this little guy, a fighter, a survivor, turned personal tragedy into a lifelong pursuit of giving hope to those in crisis and need, forever changing their lives and inspiring others to do the same. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me as we honor and congratulate Walter Camp Football Foundation Man of the Year for Florida State University, Work Done.
Thank you. It's tough to follow Ms. Adams. I mean, the words that she expressed, I mean, says a lot about life. And, you know, it takes a real person to forgive. And I remember in 2007, I was playing for the Atlanta Falcons, and I was writing a book. And in that book, I talked about going to Angola prison to meet the guy that shot and killed my mom. And for me, it was all about forgiveness. So, you know, you touched my heart and definitely brought back memories. So I definitely salute you and your journey. But I would definitely like to thank the Walter Camp Foundation for this award. You know, as a player, as an athlete, you want to get recognized for what you do on the field. But I think the things that I've been able to accomplish off the field says a lot, but I still wanted to be a Walter Camp All-American. So, Orlando Pace has been messing with me the whole time that you should have been on the team. We should have been on the team. So, but I'm honored to be here tonight. This is a huge honor and accomplishment. And my mom, you know, raising 6 kids, making $36,000 a Baton Rouge City police officer. And to understand her journey, that she's going to sacrifice her life to make sure that her kids had a roof over their head, clothes on their backs. And, you know, when I lost my mom 2 days after my 18th birthday, you know, I think I was challenged because I was pushed to the limit that, are you going to worry about work or are you going to worry about my 5 younger brothers and sisters? And I can tell you that it wasn't a thought or an afterthought. My family was first. And I've tried to live my life that way. Thank you. I've tried to live my life in a way that family is always first. And I can tell you that, you know, the Homes for the Holidays program was born because of her dream of wanting to own her own home. And, you know, I'm blessed that the program has been around going on. This is our 20th year anniversary. And we've helped 152 single parents become first-time homeowners. So, um, I can definitely say that when you're honoring me, you're honoring my mom of her journey and her dream. But I also understand the need for affordable housing and the need that as individuals who may not start off on the right foot, but everyone has a dream of that American dream of being a homeowner. And affordable housing in this country is definitely lacking, and I think we definitely need to push to help people that are trying to help themselves to be in a better situation. But I am thankful and honored that, you know, over the years I've been able to lead by example. And I can tell you, I have a nephew who's 8 years old. And for the last 6 years, instead of getting birthday presents, he's raised money for the charity so that he can furnish a room in a house for another kid. So I think over the years, you don't really know the seeds that you sow until you plant them. And years later, it comes back in fruition. So I'm definitely thankful to have a positive impact on my nephew. But again, thank you for this honor, and it's been great being here. Thank you.
Mike was always intense. He was intense from the time I first met him, which may have been 8 or 9 years old. If you did something wrong, he'd point it out to you, you know, even as a kid. And that's the way Mike was.
Well, I think that I am truly a product of America.
For young Mike Ditka, America was Aliquippa, a western Pennsylvania mill town located in the heart of steel country.
Aliquippa was a unique place. It was the epitome of America, the American dream. It was a melting pot of every color, creed, nationality, and religion. And it worked. You know why? Everybody had about the same thing. They had an opportunity to raise their families, to have a job, to put food on the table. My father worked hard. He worked in a steel mill.
The son inherited the father's demanding nature, and this fueled his competitive fire at an early age. At Aliquippa High School, Ditka was a two-platoon player and team captain for head coach Carl Ashman. He played on the Quip state championship team in 1955. 2 years later, Ditka was a highly coveted recruit.
Coach Ashman wanted me to go to Pitt.
Ditka was a two-way end at Pitt, where his defensive skills helped him earn All-American honors. On offense, he caught few passes, but his versatility made him an attractive pro prospect. In 1961, he was the Chicago Bears' first-round draft choice.
First of all, I wasn't sure I could play pro football, because most of my prowess in college or notoriety came as a defensive player. And then when I get to the Bears, I'm playing a position called tight end. And no one knew what the heck it was, really. I mean, it was kind of a new position.
Billy Wade finds his great rookie, Mike Ditka, open and whips the ball to him. Iron Mike completes a 36-yard TD strike.
You know, I caught 12 passes my senior year in college. 12. I caught 58 my first year in pro ball and 12 touchdowns.
Ditka was the NFL's Rookie of the Year.
The first thing that Mike did is change the tight end position to an attack position. Before Mike Ditka came along, the tight ends were guys that blocked, and once in a while you throw them a pass and get a 10-yard completion. Mike Ditka changed all that because he could get downfield, and he transformed the tight end position to kind of what it is now.
Ditka was the first tight end to be used as an offensive weapon. He would eventually become the first tight end inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame.
I could never outrun anybody. I had to wait till they catch up and try to slug them.
He played football and he coached football the only way he knew how. And that's just beat the guy across from you every single play. I think he was a throwback, you know. He could have played in any era.
Iron Mike Powers for the final 30 yards on a 47-yard play.
Iron Mike was one of the fiercest competitors of his era. He was voted to 5 Pro Bowls during his 6 seasons in Chicago. 1963, Ditka helped the Bears win a world championship. But he and head coach George Halas were on a collision course. The impact would change Ditka's career and life.
So Halas traded Ditka. Maybe part of it was out of spite. It was a big mistake. But they had very similar personalities.
As a player and as a man, Ditka crash-landed in Philadelphia.
He didn't want to be there. He was played for a bad team. Didn't like the coaching staff, and mainly didn't like himself. He started drinking and admitted it was a problem.
You know, when you find people who lean on alcohol or drugs, then they're copping out. They're weak, and I became weak at that time. And that was a person I didn't like very much in my life. I had no career after Philadelphia. I was retiring when I got the phone call from Coach Landry, and he told me very honestly, he said, I traded for you. He said, but I'm not sure you can play anymore. He said, I'll take a chance on you if you take a chance on yourself. And I probably became the best player I ever was in Dallas because I became a team player. I didn't care how many passes I caught or how many touchdowns I made. I cared about the success of the Cowboys and Coach Landry and my teammates. And I really did, and I can honestly say that. I was part of Tom's first one, and God, that was great.
Tomac drops back to pass. That's up.
Ditka played for 3 years in Dallas. Then, in 1973, Landry asked him to become special teams coach. He served 8 seasons as a Cowboys assistant, but he yearned to be a head coach, and there was only one team he wanted to lead.
Now, as I present Mike to you, please treat him as nicely as you did.
Well, the general perception was, we love Mike Ditka, he's an iconic player. This is no head coach.
At first, the Mike Ditka brand was a tough sell in Chicago.
Get out of the weak side, you dumb son of a. Get in there, Mosley.
He was brutish. He was volatile. He had a perm. He was exactly what the Bears needed.
I wanted the Bears to be the best. I wanted the Bears to have the best reputation. I wanted them to be the toughest, and I wanted to win the championship. And I told our team when I got there, I got good news and bad news. The good news is we're going to win a Super Bowl here. The bad news is a lot of you people aren't going to be here when we do it. And I didn't mean that to be cruel. I meant it to be factual. That if you weren't willing to pay the price, you weren't going to be there, period.
Ditka was not an easy man to get along with.
So you called your husband Coach or Mike?
Ass.
And nobody knew that better than the quarterbacks who played for him in New Orleans and Chicago.
Well, he was tough on quarterbacks, there's no doubt. But, you know, playing in that offense is not good for quarterbacks anyway. I mean, everybody knew. Third and long, we're going to run sweep with Walter. So I just call something else. And he did blow up a lot of times. He'd yell at me, I yelled back at him, and everything was fine. Mike always thought I did it just to piss him off. And I didn't. I wanted to win football games.
McMahon wasn't the only one.
As Flutie throws and nearly has that one picked off.
Ditka is going to eat a sneaker. Flutie changed at the line of scrimmage. He's got more head by the jersey. Get in there and tell him what I want done.
He just expects you to be mentally tough. He expects you to be a football player. He expects you to be hard. And those are the kind of guys he wanted playing for him. That's the kind of guy he is himself.
You got to love it. He was this way as a player. He'd come back and practically punch out his own quarterback.
Ditka remade the Bears in his image. Tough-nosed players who didn't take crap from anyone. In 1984, Ditka led the Bears to their first postseason victory in 20 years. The players fed off his raw emotion. That attitude was the driving force behind the 1985 Bears, a team led by Walter Payton, Jim McMahon, and Buddy Ryan's 46 defense. A defense that still resonates today. The Bears ground the life out of their opponents like an overchewed stick of gum. They embarrassed the NFC's top teams on their way to a 15-1 record. They were the Bruce Brothers, the Grabowskis, a perfect reflection of their Steel Town coach.
Look at the postseason when they came together like no team ever has. They gave up 10 points in three games. They toyed with their opponents.
McMahon rolling left, looking to deal. He fires left side of the end zone.
Super Bowl in New Orleans, it was like there was one team in town.
This defense has been incredible. They knock your socks off just to watch it. First and goal from the 1 yard line. Hand off to the Grand Champion!
When it was over, Mike Ditka reigned as the King of Chicago. Ditka's larger-than-life personality still resonates today. He is still blunt and outspoken, and still very much in demand as a speaker, endorser, and actor. As the face of gridiron greats, Ditka is a passionate advocate on behalf of retired players who have fallen on hard times. The organization provides financial assistance to former pros who need medical care and other basic necessities.
Football doesn't owe me anything. I owe my whole life to football. If somebody said, okay, here's what's going to happen to you. When you're 72, you're going to feel this way. Will you play the game? I said, absolutely, I'd play the game. I'd even play it harder than I played it.
Mike Ditka played and coached as hard as anyone in NFL history.
I've never known anybody quite like Mike Ditka. He was one of a kind. He's the epitome of what Chicago wanted in a football player and a football coach.
Ditka stood for more than, you know, winning and losing. He just had that little look about him that said, we're gonna kick some butt today, but we're also gonna have a little fun doing it. And we're going to share it with you, the fans.
You know, I think Sinatra said it pretty good. Regrets, I had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I think you always have a few regrets. But, you know, if you live in the past, you die in the past. I'm not going to go back and rehash all the stuff that people want to rehash. I don't care what you've ever done in your life. It has nothing to do with what you're going to do now or what you can do. You know, the past is history. Tomorrow's a mystery. Today is a gift. That's why they call it the present.
Our final honoree tonight was once described by the Chicago superfans on Saturday Night Live like the sun, only brighter. As a kid who grew up in Green Bay, Wisconsin, idolized Walter Payton, I agree. Coach, there's one guy in Green Bay that thinks Mikowski was over the line. That's me. I'm the only guy. To introduce the 2016 Distinguished American Award, we call to the microphone Jeff Hubbard, president of the Connecticut and Western Massachusetts market at KeyBank.
Thank you, John. Let me begin by saying what an honor it is for KeyBank to serve as a presenting sponsor. We've been presenting sponsor for the Walter Camp Foundation since 2010. Friday morning, Ernie Williams, past president of the Walter Camp Foundation, grabbed me and said, I'm going to introduce you to Mike Ditka. You get to introduce him on Saturday night. Like many of you, I was very excited for this opportunity to meet Mike. So dutifully, I ran over. Mike, I'm Jeff Hubbard. I'm going to introduce you Saturday night. He paused and he put his hand up, and I thought, this is going to be great. Coach Ditka is going to give me some advice. He puts that big hand on my shoulder and pulls me in, says, buddy, let's just make it fast. So to that end, it is my pleasure to introduce to you the Distinguished American Award winner for 2017, Iron Mike Ditka.
You got that one?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. I want to say one thing first. If BS was cement, these guys could build a highway to heaven. Damn, I knew I was good, but not that good.
It's been a heck of a road, you know. I've been had my ups and downs and ins and outs, and I've probably made a lot of people mad and disappointed at times, you know. But I read something a long time ago. Yeah, regrets, I have a few, but then again, too few to mention. And I think that, you know, I set goals for myself. I was fortunate, though. My father was the toughest guy I've ever met. He was in the Marines when I was born, and when we came home from the Marines, I got my ass beat a lot. But he taught me right from wrong, and I understood it. Had a great high school coach, Carl Ashman. He was in the film. Had a great college coach at Pitt. Then I went to the Bears, and I was coached by the great George Halas. After he got tired of my act, after 6 years, he shipped me off to Philadelphia, where I was in purgatory for 2 years, and then I moved on to Dallas with Coach Landry. I got to heaven, and that was the turning point in my life as a person and as a player. And I think I came full circle because of meeting that man, Tom Landry. And, you know, I'm not perfect. I don't profess to be perfect. It's been a heck of a run, like I said. I've done good. I've done bad. But I would tell you young men something. The game was my life. Respect the game. It's not about showboating. It's not about calling attention to yourself. Football is the most consummate team sport there is. You can't do a damn thing without the guy beside you or behind you or in front of you. It's that simple. You've got 11 on a side. Enjoy it. Respect it. They're your teammates. It's the most amazing team game I've ever seen. And when it works, it's beautiful. And when it works, it's beautiful. But it takes everybody pulling for the same thing. It's not about individual accomplishments. I caught a lot of passes when I played. That wasn't the goal. I liked the short one I caught where I got to run over somebody. Now, that was a little bit of fun. You know, and I played against some pretty tough guys, too. You know, you didn't always run over Herb Adderley or the guys like that. They would knock you right on your ass. So, but, it, you know, it, like I said, I could probably sit up here and tell you I got regrets. I hear Sandra talking, and, you know, what's important in life? What she dedicated her life to, the child, the way she lives her life, the way she cares. I mean, there's a special place for people like her in heaven, and she'll be in heaven, and I believe that. I mean, God takes care of the good people in this world. She's a special person. And I see in other people up here, too. If somebody would have told me when I was 8 years old or 9 years old, trying to play football or baseball or basketball, I played them all. None of them good. I did have one thing. I guarded Jerry West in basketball when he was at West Virginia. I was at Pitt. I didn't guard him very long. I guarded him about 5 minutes. I had five fouls. He had 20 points. I tried, but I want to thank you very much. I want to say one thing. I saw the award. What's it say again? This is pretty interesting. Distinguished American. I'll tell you what I am. I'm a proud American. You know, we have a lot of things that are wrong. We don't cry about it. We fix these things over a period of time. We've done it through the history of this country. We'll continue to do it. Hopefully we get it right. We'll never get it perfect, but we'll get it right. And, I, you know, like I said, I'm just proud to be an American. I'm proud that I was born at the time I was. And God has, you know, he's really blessed me. And not that I speed or talent or anything like that. He blessed me with a heart and desire to maybe be something that I didn't think I could be, so I worked a little harder at it. So all I'm saying is, for you young guys out there, I think this is very important. If you put limits on yourself, that's as far as you'll ever go. There's no reason to put a limit on. The sky's the limit. If you set a goal, set it high. And if you don't hit the goal, whatever the hell you hit will be a lot better than what you're at right now. And I really believe that. Okay. How many come in here? I listen to Warwick Dunn. I was coaching when Warwick came in the league. I mean, those guys killed us down in Tampa. Are you kidding me? I saw a lot of those highlights in there were against us, the Bears, when I was coaching. That wasn't fun, but, you know, it happens. But I just want to say sincerely to the players, respect the game, give everything. You know, I want to tell you first, I'll leave it one last thing. My first contract in the pro football was $12,000 a year with a $6,000 signing bonus. That's true. That's what I got. I made All-Pro Rookie of the Year and caught about 58 passes that year or something. So there were no multi-year contracts, so I go in and I speak to George Halas. I'm sitting right across the desk from the guy who started the National Football League. And he looks at me and he says this. He said, "Kid," he called everybody, kid, you had a good year. Pretty good year, he said. You know, you did this, you did. You know, but I had to fine you twice. You missed curfew. And I did, and he fined me $500 each time. Now, you know, and this is true. But then he came up with this one. He said, "But it's okay." He said, "I'm going to give you 12,000. No, I'm going to give you 14,000 this year." Which, you know, he assumed it was a $2,000 raise. So I'm a pretty smart guy. I'm sitting there. I said, "Coach, 12 and 6 is 18." I said, "I'd be damned if I'd sign for a penny less than 18." As soon as I said it, he opened the drawer, pulled out a contract for $18,000, and I signed it. I never got a raise, but he knew he wasn't going to give me a raise. That was it. But thank you so much. I'm not distinguished, but I'm proud. Thank you.
Coach. All right, I'm going to beg your indulgence. 2 more minutes, and then I'm out of here. And I mean it. I'm really out. It has been my privilege to MC this dinner 10 times. So I couple that with the 50th anniversary. I think the numbers are perfect, and I can get out. I'm not tired of it. I love it. I just feel like I am hogging it. So with my deep gratitude to Tom Lally, who was the first guy to call me on the advice of Mark May, you have my appreciation. To the 6 presidents, Alan Jackson, John Barbarotta, Al Palalillo, John Marks, Jim Monaco, and Rob Kaufman, who've had me, I say thank you. To all of you who have endured me, Mizzou Jokes and USC Song Girls, I thank you. And finally, the man who puts together this dinner every year and literally guides me through it so I don't screw it up impossibly so that there's always one the next year. Doc back there, Jim Mandillo, with the help of Tony Martello. My thanks to both of you. I appreciate all you that come. I appreciate you supporting the Walter Camp Football Foundation, all the good work it does. So keep it up. Save me a beer, because next January I'm going to sit with you. So now I can take off my MC badge. And since they did that, I can now put one on that says honorary member of the Walter Camp Football Foundation. Thank you. And to put an amen to our evening, here again, Reverend Owen Sanderson with our benediction.
Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to come together tonight to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the Walter Camp Football Foundation. We hope that the inspiration which we have received and the awards which we have given may be a small token of appreciation for what we appreciate in the great game of football. We ask your blessing to be with all the recipients tonight as they continue on their journey in life. May they be successful and put to use the things which they have learned on the gridiron and as a member of a football team. These things we ask, O Lord, in your name. And now as we depart, we ask your blessing to be upon us. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Amen.
Our last housekeeping note, because nothing's better than after a prayer than to remind you that the after party is located at Bar on Crown Street. Your dinner ticket, your tuxedo, the VIP card will get you through the door. On behalf of the Walter Camp Football Foundation, thank you for attending the 50th National Awards Dinner. Good night, everybody.
blah, 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 blah,